This is a Media Lab podcast. Welcome to Putting It Together. This is the podcast that goes through the entire body of work of Stephen Sondheim, show by show and song by song. My name is Kyle Marshall, your self-described Sondheim expert. This is kind of a special show here today. It is just me talking with you, the listener. No guests here this week. And this is going to be a bit of a throwback to a special episode I did, I don't even know now, like over a year ago or something like that, which is going through what I feel are the best songs from a certain time period of Stephen Sondheim's career. The previous one was everything before 1970, so anything that he wrote pre-1970. And today we're doing it from a shorter period, from 1970 to 1975. Now, here's kind of my prerequisites for this. This is songs when they were released, not when they were written. So that's why if you're like a huge fan of Country House from that London production of Follies, you're not going to see it here, which I'm a huge fan of, and maybe it'll show up in a future edition of one of these episodes. But this also excludes Pacific Overtures completely. Yes, it was being written in that time period, but it did not premiere until 1976. So that is what we're going to be doing here today, and we might as well get right into it. Let's listen to a little bit of intro music, and then when I return, you're going to hear me talk about my personal top 10 Stephen Sondheim songs from 1970 until 1975.
I love to travel, don't you? I love a change of pace, I love a change of space, I love to see a place that's absolutely new.
Sweat,
I love to travel, bump, don't you?
Limp,
of course you do.
All
right, well, that, of course, as we fade in from the music, is a song from The Frogs. I realize we have not talked about The Frogs yet on this show. The next two episodes are going to be devoted to that production. So all you frog fanatics out there are going to get your fill over the next couple of weeks. That being said, that is my honorable mention, okay? I have gotten a small appreciation for some of the music from that production. I'm still not really a big fan of the show in general. I've now listened to a couple of scores. I watched the bootleg. Like, it is a show that I don't have a deep fondness for, but there's some music that I definitely wouldn't kick out of bed. And call me romantic, I suppose, but there is something about that song, I Love to Travel, that is so resonant to me right now, because boy, do I want to get back to traveling. You know, Broadway has just announced all of its openings. I'm really hoping that this is not a premature celebration, that things are at the end. I'm still a bit leery of actually getting onto an airplane, which is probably why I'm not necessarily going to do a New York trip until the new year sometime. I'm thinking probably March. But that idea, that explosion of like, I love to travel, is something that I very much appreciate that The Frogs gave us.
I should also point out the fact that the other person in the scene hates traveling, mostly because he has to lug around Dionysus's huge bag everywhere that they go. So there's, you know, a duality of why I think this song is great.
Now, I do have to give a bit of a disclaimer here at the very beginning, because this, of course, is my own personal list. This did not go through like a massive amount of people to do fact checking. It's my own personal list of my 10 favorite songs that Sondheim wrote between 1970 and 1975. And as such, it's probably going to change tomorrow. I mean, it's probably going to change like 5 minutes after I finish this podcast. But right now, this is what those 10 songs are. I know it's not going to line up with yours, but I'd love to know what your lists are. You can send those to puttingittogetherpodcast@gmail.com. Here is my bold number 10. All right, this is already going to make so many people mad. But let's listen to those first few notes of this song.
Thank you.
we a pair? Me here at last.
Yes, that's right. I am putting Send in the Clowns, Sondheim's most popular song of all time, at the number 10 position. And this is that weird conversation I have to get into with people, which is like, hey, like, I enjoy Send in the Clowns, but it's not even like my favorite song from A Little Night Music, let alone my favorite Sondheim song of all time. So it always feels like I'm dismissing it when that's never been my intention. I really love this song. Now, I will say, I don't think anybody has even come close to nailing this emotion than Glynis Johns has. Yes, I understand. I have watched the Judi Dench version. I've listened to the Judi Dench version. I adore the Judi Dench version. Glynis Johns just has something else to it. And maybe it is the fact that it was written directly for her and her vocal range that it just hits me. There's something so pathetic, I guess, a little bit about this song that's so yearning, that's so sad, and yet so defiant at the same time. There's all these emotions that are getting wrapped up into the music and into the lyrics here that I can't help but just be swayed by that performance. You know, on the episode where we talked about Send in the Clowns, I had a great discussion around the fact that Sondheim never meant this to be circus themed. Like, it was never meant to be that type of clown. It was always meant to be the theater clown. But what I love about the lyrics is that you can kind of read it either way. And this is the English major in me, I know, where I love alternate interpretations using the same source material, where you can, through you know, explanation and your own experience, have that reading be either one. Now, I will say, yes, when I first heard it, I thought they meant literal clowns. As I got more into theater and theater history, I understood what the connotation was actually supposed to be. But there's nothing quite like that last exclamation that the character Desiree gives. Well, maybe next year, you know, maybe next year will be the year that belongs to me. You're kind of giving up. It's like, this should be the song of 2020, really. It's like, you know what? Maybe next year will be the year that we, that I hit the heights that I want to hit.
And where are the clowns? There ought to be clowns. Well, maybe next year.
Okay, number 9 is another song written for a very specific woman and her life story.
Good times and bum times, I've seen them all, and my dear, I'm still here. Plush velvet sometimes just pretzels and beer, but I'm here. I've stuffed the dailies in my shoes.
Yes, that's right. This is from Follies. It's the song I'm Still Here, the character of Carlotta. But in the original production, that was played by Yvonne DiCarlo. And a lot of her backstory was worked into the story of this song specifically. There's just that great crescendo from like swingy little jazzy tune all the way up to like this big brassy, like, I'm still here, damn it. Like, that's what it feels like to me. It's just like this huge proclamation at the end of that song. I know that a lot of people also use this at the end of 2020, where they're like, hey, we made it through. We had this huge worldwide shared trauma together, but we're still here. And maybe this will be something that we continue to go back to at the end of this whole thing, this whole pandemic. But for me, to go right down into the nuts and bolts of the show, I love that this is basically that pivot point. It's really the fulcrum, if you want me to use like a really fancy word, of kind of that middle point of the show, where this starts the teetering over into the psycho follies, as Sondheim likes to call it. And it is really this character that does like show up in other book scenes, but doesn't really have another song, at least not another solo song, here in the show. So it's interesting that they gave it, of course, to this other character that just shows up. This is also one of those things that I really love that Sondheim is able to do well, which is that story song, right? We're telling a story from her very early days of getting into the entertainment business all the way up to where she is right now. And we're not, like, we're getting snatches of information, but we're not going into, like, long passages of what it felt like to be in the early Follies or doing films or what she even means by, like, going from, of doing that progression from Slow Eyed Vamp to Someone's Mother to now you're doing camp. You know, that journey, we just understand it because we've seen that story play out so many times with different actors and actresses that we can kind of fill in the blanks ourselves. We don't need, like, specific, like, this is exactly what happened to me. And if you haven't seen the movie Postcards from the Edge, there is a great interpretation of this song from Shirley MacLaine that I'm a big fan of. I'm also reading the Mike Nichols biography that's out right now. And loving it, by the way. There is so many cool Sondheim tidbits in that book because him and Mike Nichols were basically friends. So definitely pick it up to learn more about Mike Nichols. But the benefit of doing so is you also get these really interesting insights into Sondheim at that time in, like, the late 60s into the 70s and then finally into the 80s. Anyways, this is a long road to say that Postcards from the Edge is directed by Mike Nichols, so I've been rewatching and sometimes watching for the first time all the movies that get mentioned that he directed as I go through the book.
I got through all of last year, and I'm here. Lord knows at least I've been there, and I'm here. Who's here?
You know, I did not plan this, but once again, number 8 is another song that was written for a very specific performer in its respective show. This one, of course, is from Company.
Another 100 people just got off of the train and came up through the ground pile. Another 100 people just got off of the bus and are looking around at another 100 people who got off of the plane and are looking at us who got off of the train. Played in the bus maybe yesterday. It's a city of strangers. Some come to work, some to play. A city of strangers. Some come to stare, some to stay. And every day, the ones who stay.
So this was written for the performer Pam Myers, Pamela Myers. And there's a great little story that Sondheim writes about in his book Finishing the Hat about how this character of Marta was supposed to be Jewish. That's what the character was written as. However, once Pamela Myers strode on the stage and did her audition, they were like, we have a discovery on our hands here, and we would be idiots to be like, no, we cannot hire you. Even though she fit, like, the bill of, like, blonde, beautiful, skinny, Midwestern girl, you know, all the prerequisites for Broadway stardom. Or so they say. And then originally, if I remember correctly, this was cut. And then she took it with such grace that Sondheim was like, no, this won't stand. I'm going to get this back into the show. And he was able to convince the other creators that it had to go back in. Another 100 People Talking About New York City is always a song I think about when I go back and visit, where you get off the plane or you do arrive into downtown Manhattan and you just see so many people. There's cars and buses and trains, and you can see the planes off in the distance flying and boats in the harbor, and it's just like there is so many people. So it's easy to internalize, God, there is just another 100 people I've just walked past and interacted with, and they're just going about their days. And I think one of the successes for Company for me is that even though there isn't that traditional narrative, there are these little themes that get thrown out every so often throughout the show, where, or at least I, am so caught up in the journey, the emotional journey that Bobby is going through, that it's sometimes nice to see these other characters come on and be like, gosh, they're this city of strangers, right? You're trying to find love, you're trying to find the one,
And it's so hard because, again, you go outside and it's just another 100 people that walk past. It's so easy to feel like you're that insignificant nothing that's wandering around. What makes you so special that when you eventually get to being alive, that it pays off so well? Because it's like, man, like, we have felt this emotion and we've heard from these other characters and we've seen how Bobby has reacted to these other couples in his life. And this is a great one that kind of ushers us into to that end moment. And I have to say, I also loved a little bit of insight into dating in the late 60s to early 70s. You know, they meet at parties through the friends of friends who they never know. Will you pick me up, or do I meet you there, or shall we let it go? Did you get my message because I looked in vain? Can we see each other Tuesday if it doesn't rain? Look, I'll call you in the morning, or my service will explain. I know we don't use call services anymore. But that whole idea is like, oh, trying to make plans is hard. And as a single man who is now just past his mid-30s, dating online is the fucking worst. Sorry, excuse my language, but it is the fucking worst. I hate it. Mostly because I have to tell my same, like, three stories that are in my back pocket. And it's like, I'm bored of myself at this point. Did you know that I host a Sondheim podcast? And then you see their eyes just glaze over and realize, like, this isn't going to work, but I'm still going to pay for your dinner because I am a gentleman. Anyways, that's a huge tangent to say that I'd love another 100 people.
And another 100 people just got off of the train. And another 100 people just got off of the train. And another 100 people just got off of the train. Another 100 people just got off of the train!
Number 7 is another song from Company. Another song that is really tied to the original performer, I think. I really didn't do this on purpose, I swear, but... Well, I mean, take it away, Elaine.
I'd like to propose a toast. Here's to the ladies who lunch. Everybody laugh. Lounging in their caftans and planning a brunch on their own.
Yes, it is the Ladies Who Lunch. I love this song. I also love the fact that there was a listener who reached out a few months ago, I think at this point, who understands time anymore. And they mentioned the fact that my interpretation is based on what Sondheim has said in interviews about how no one ever actually rose up off their feet when Elaine Stritch gave those commands at the end, like, everybody rise, 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 you know, those proclamations she's doing from the stage. And at least on the night that he went to see this, that is what happened. So I love the fact that that happened. I would love to be in a production where people are compelled to, like, jump up to their feet because someone on the stage is yelling at them to do so. But I also just love, again, the character that gets brought out in this song, the kind of story that's being told here as well, right? Because you're getting to know a little bit more about the character of Joanne through this. But I think this is sinking in to Bobby as well. Like, you know, here's to all these other girls that are doing this. But there's, like, a safe way to go about your life. And then there is this more, like, courageous way to go about your life. At least that's how I feel about this, right? Because she's already a bit drunk in this scene anyways, and you can feel her getting just more and more irritated as the song goes on. Here's to the girls who just watch. Aren't they the best? When they get depressed, it's a bottle of scotch plus a little jest. Another chance to disapprove, another brilliant zinger, another reason not to move, another vodka stinger, and then, like, ah! Like, I feel like that's a little bit... maybe talking about her past specifically. That may not necessarily explain her now, but that might be something that was, like, in her past here as well. And but there's other people she brings up here that I do think are just people that she's observed. The people who the girls who stay smart, the girls on the go, you know, people that are going off to the gym, then to a fitting, all these people who are just really keeping up those appearances. For me, there is that mocking nature that this song has. She's judging all these other women that have basically lived nothing lives.
trying to urge Bobby, I think, to just make that choice, right? Like, you have to go out and do something, you know, somebody, not somebody. That's not Joanne who says that, I know. But, you know, I think everyone is urging him to do anything in his life instead of just staying where he is. This is her attempt to push him out of this fog that's been in his brain the entire show. And once again, there's been other great performers who have done this song. Elaine Stritch, there's no one who's ever matched her performance.
Let's hear it for the ladies who want everybody wrong.
All right, that means we're here to number six. We're going back to A Little Night Music and the song that I got the most egg on my face here in the past year.
At the villa of the Baron de Signac, where I spent a somewhat infamous year. At the villa of the Baron de Signac, I had ladies in attendance, fire over pendants, liaisons. What's happened to them?
Yes, it's Liaisons. A song that I have to tell you was not necessarily one of my favorites, but having done the deep dive on this song, watching multiple performances of this, re-listening over and over, and maybe it's a form of Stockholm syndrome, that could very well be true. I love this song. It is such a great story told in 3 minutes about this woman's journey of going from basically nothing to owning her own property. By yes, using her body and using her mental faculties, but she essentially was like an escort, to put it nicely, who worked her way up to being deeded a duchy. Like, how great is that? Also, I don't know if you know this, but hawk means wine. I put the call out on social media, on Instagram and Twitter. I have to say, Liaisons and another song were basically tied for first place. And especially on Instagram, Liaisons was by far the number one choice that people answered to the question, like, what song would you pick as being the best Sondheim song from 1970 to 1975? There is a deep love of this song. Weirdly, over on the Patreon, maybe this tells you a lot about the people who are helping support me over on the Patreon, it got 0 votes. So I'll tell you in a moment which one was the number one choice from the people over there. But it's really interesting to see how this breaks down, depending on which social media platform you use, which one edges the other ones out. What somebody wrote on Instagram specifically was that it has to be Liaisons, a 3-act tragedy / daydream. I think that's a great encapsulation of this song. I think there's that dreamy quality that you get right from the very beginning of the song, her telling her story, the amazing rhyme of raisins and liaisons, which is chef's kiss of being able to put those two together, putting those two together and not really calling attention to itself. I love that. And once again, this is becoming like a Sondheim thing, writing for a very specific performer in mind. In this case, Hermione Gingold. It's the exception to the ones I've talked about before. I do think other people perform this song really, really well. I don't think that this is only good when it's sung by Hermione Gingold. It pretty much slays every performance I have seen, every bootleg I've watched, every production I have seen. Like, it does so good. The fact that they cut this out of the movie is a shame. I mean, the whole movie is a shame, but the fact that they cut this song out just drives me nuts.
Our employers, where the amateur prevails and delicacy fails to pay. In a world where the princes are lawyers, what can anyone expect except to recollect? Yes.
Okay, what I'm going to do now, we're at the halfway point, so I'm going to go thank some sponsors, and then when we come back, I'll finish off this list of the best songs that Sondheim wrote from 1970 to 1975.
A change of menu, the feeling when you meet with something strange. Slug. I love to travel, slug. I love a challenge, slug. I love slug. Change.
Slug. Trip, trip, slip, trip, catch.
Are we there yet? Because my feet have definitely lost interest.
Stop complaining, such is life. Each
Hopefully I haven't been making too many people hugely upset by the order of songs I put in here. But let me tell you this, if you want to help support this show, make it better, make it allow me to focus more of my time and energy on this and maybe do way more research, you can help support this show, of course, absolutely free, right? You can give this a rating or review on whatever app you listen to podcasts in. But if you want to help monetarily, you can go over to our Patreon page. Please do not donate if it impacts you negatively financially. By the way, we do have a new patron this week, which is Jeff. So thank you so much, Jeff, for doing that and joining up over on the Patreon. I also need to give a huge thanks to the God That's Good tier, which is Jack, Todd, and Carrie. And of course, Putting It Together is a proud member of the Alberta Podcast Network, locally grown, community supported. The Alberta Podcast Network promotes and supports Alberta-made podcasts and connects their audiences with Alberta-based businesses and organizations. This week, we are sponsored by Pod Power. With Pod Power, our sponsors are making it possible for us to amplify the voices of Albertans and Alberta podcasters. This episode, Edmonton Community Foundation is helping us give a Pod Power shout out to Your Forest. Your Forest is a podcast about the natural world. Hear stories about the environment, renewable resources, conservation, forestry, hunting, fishing, and more. This is a podcast for those who cannot live without the joys and wonders of all wild things. Find Your Forest wherever you get your podcasts or at yourforestpodcast.com. That's yourforestpodcast.com. This week, we are also brought to you by Roomy. You know, with warmer weather comes yard work, and lots of it. Prune your trees and shrubs, clean your eaves troughs, replace those drafty windows you noticed over the winter. Pause just for a second in this ad copy. If you do use leaf blowers, though, please die 100 deaths. They're the worst. You know, you could do this all yourself, or you can call Roomy to take care of all your outdoor and indoor spring home maintenance while you fire up the barbecue and relax. Visit roomy.ca, that's R-U-M-I.ca, or you can call 1-844-777-7864 and let Roomy's trusted local experts take care of your yard so that all you have to do is enjoy it. I apologize for saying to die 1,000 deaths, but the reason being is that, especially when we do podcasting here, that is my arch nemesis. Just leaf blowers going on all throughout the day. And it's like, just be quiet for an hour so that I can record this and I have to hear that humming in the background. Also, it's friggin' annoying. So stop it. At 7, Rick? Really? At 7? Anyways, let's get back to the episode.
March, trudge, trudge, stop.
The sun comes up, I think about you. The coffee cup, I think about you. I want you so, it's like I'm losing my mind.
Well, you're hearing the number 5 song here, Losing My Mind. Sung along to by one of my new favorite detectives of Benoit Blanc from the film Knives Out. He does sing along to this song in, as part of the movie. And it's great. I don't want to be so bold to say Sondheim does this the best, but he's definitely one of the best people to write mental breakdowns of characters and do it in such a convincing manner of this song, where once again, we go kind of step by step through her day. I love how he structured that as going from morning, afternoon, and then finally into evening, and really showing how Sally
is not really holding it all together. She really holds on to the past to such a degree that it impacts her relationships, her family, because it doesn't sound like she has the greatest time with her kids. Definitely doesn't have the best relationship with her husband. And, you know, the morning ends, I think about you. I talk with friends, I think about you. We've all been there, too. We've all been in those relationships that end up being kind of one-sided, where it's like, I am obsessing about you as a person, but not really thinking of you as a person either. It's still all about me, me, me throughout this song. Anyways, Losing My Mind is great, and I don't think you need me to tell you why it's great.
You said you loved me. Or were you just being kind? Or am I losing my mind?
All right, that brings us to the number four position. Number four, I'm giving to The Miller's Son.
I shall marry the miller's son, pin my hat on a nice piece of property. Friday nights for a bit of fun, we'll go dancing. Meanwhile, it's a wink and a wiggle and a giggle on the grass, and I'll trip the life.
That's right, we're here in A Little Night Music again. I still think it's so fascinating that they give basically like the end song. Yes, there's a reprise of Send in the Clowns that really finishes off the show, but to really highlight the themes of the show, to wrap it all up, it's the song The Miller's Son, sung by Petra, this side character who has been there throughout the entire show, but hasn't really had her own song yet. And she gets to nail it. I know people are going to disagree with me, but I have yet to see someone that has not performed this song well. It is nearly indestructible. If you are a good singer and you sing it as it's written, it's really hard to screw this up. It's like really hard to screw this song up. I really love this song also as part of the Sondheim disco album that came out here last year, which is great. I listen to that album so many times. It's gotten me through some pretty dark periods over the last year, let me tell you that. And The Miller's Son's still great on that. So this is where I'm saying that I think it's pretty indestructible as a song. And it's another story. I talking about liaisons there earlier about how she, Madame Armfelt, goes through kind of these three people at kind of three stages of her life. This is also the same thing with Petra, going through three different men. Imagine now in this case of a different possibilities that her future could have, but going through like those three different parts that could happen, and imagining what her life could be, but then still resolving on that end of like, and I will marry the miller's son. Like that's the final statement they said in this song. And in my mind means like that is the decision that she is making too. She's going to go for a life that's not going to be full of riches, but is going to be full of happiness instead, which then I should say the show sums up by going, yes, I'm going to finally follow my heart and go for love, but they're all also obscenely wealthy. So, I mean, I don't, so the very ending kind of subverts this message here a little bit, but the Miller's Son is still phenomenal.
When I die, and a person should celebrate everything passing by. And I shall marry the miller's son.
Number three is a song from Follies. I think I admitted to this, but if I didn't, I'm going to admit to it now. Follies was a little bit of a blind spot for me going in.
Not that I didn't know some of the songs. I did. I knew some of the songs actually quite well. I'm Still Here, Losing My Mind. I even knew like Rain on the Roof, weirdly enough, pretty well. But there were certain songs that I didn't really know. I'd never really seen the show. I did not listen to this when I was growing up. So a lot of it was kind of new information here for me. And the song is sung by Phyllis, and it's Could I Leave You?
Leave you, leave you, how could I leave you? How could I go it alone? Could I wave the years away with a quick goodbye? How do you wipe tears away when your eyes are dry?
Sweetheart, this is one of my absolute favorite, like, F-U moments of musical theater. Her squaring off with her husband. You think you're so smart. You think that you know everything, and you know nothing. I could destroy you with my little finger, and the only reason that you are still alive is because I choose you to be alive. That's what it feels like to me. And the moment that she gets that, like, spitting fire moment, I'll take the grand, you take the spin it, now just wait a goddamn minute. I love that turn, and she just goes right into it, like, could you leave me? That is the real question of you. So am I going to leave you? Yeah, no, I'm not. And what does that say about me? But don't pretend that you're the one who has the authority in this situation. It's a great song. It's such a great performance. This could also be performed outside of the context of the show, I think. I think most of these could. Send in the Clowns, you have to change it a little bit. I think that Barbara Streisand had a good idea with that one of having that extra bridge in there. A lot of these other ones are story songs, so that you can't actually perform them outside of the context of the show, and they can still work. And this one is chief among them. I love Could I Leave You?
Could I leave you? Yes. Will I leave you? Will I leave you?
Okay, number two. This is going to be another one that maybe people are going to get mad at that I put it at number two instead of at number one. Number two is from Company, and it's Being Alive.
Someone to hold you too close. Someone to hurt you too deep. Someone to sit in your chair to ruin your sleep.
That's true. More than that.
Is that all you think there is to it?
You've got so many reasons for not being with someone, but Robert, you haven't one good reason for being alone.
Come on, you're onto something, Bobby. You're onto something.
Someone to need you too much.
Someone this song speaks to me a lot. Like I said, I am single, just past 35 by a couple of years, and I understand what it's like. It's like, I want to have someone to hold me too close. I want to have someone ruin my sleep, and I want to push through that. I think that talking with Kurt Peterson last week, he gave that great insight about how you have to kind of go from that bit of anger to that bit of happiness acceptance. Like, you have to have that turn inside of the songs, because there's that slight bit of word change from someone to somebody. I need that somebody in my life. That's an individual that I'm looking for. Someone is a little bit more grand, where it's like anyone could fit in here. But then we flip that to somebody. And I think that performance needs to come through to make this moment work. And I have seen this from the great Raul Esparza. There's phenomenal performances from Dean Jones and other people. And this is a song that you kind of understand that you have to act through as well. This is one of those things where I'm perfectly fine with someone not being the best singer, but being a great actor, because they can do so much with this song to hit me so incredibly deeply. So I know Sondheim is not a big fan of this song, but it speaks to me on such a personal and deep level that it has to be this high up. So I'm giving it number two to Being Alive.
Somebody make me come through. I'll always be there, as frightened as you.
the hell to survive being alive, being alive, being alive.
Number one is, in my personal opinion, the best Act One closer of any Broadway musical ever made. So we're going back to a little night music, and it is, of course, A Weekend in the Country.
Look, ma'am, an invitation here, ma'am, delivered by hand. And ma'am, I notice the stationery's engraved and very grand. Petra, how too exciting, just when I need it. Petra's an elegant writing, so chic, you hardly can read it. What do you think? Who can it be? Even the ink, no, here, let me.
Sondheim had done these types of songs before. He had had the idea of having different people singing, coming together, overlapping their dialogue, all coming together at the very end. He would go on to make this be something that he was a little bit known for. I think A Weekend in the Country is chief among them. This is such a brilliant song. It is perhaps the one that would not really work outside of the context of the show. I don't know, that may not be exactly 100% true, but I feel like this is the closest one that kind of needs to be within the show, so you get the full weight of it when it arrives, that you can't like take it out of the show and have the same emotional connection to it. I think this is funny too. I think it's a funny song. It's weird to hear that. I just noticed that I didn't really put any of the funny songs that Sondheim does right. There's like a little bit of comedy beats in a few of these, but definitely would not call them funny. But Weekend in the Country is so great. And it's like, I can't understand anybody who would be able to see that and then be like, I'm not coming back for Act Two. I'm good. It's that good. It's actually so good that it kind of impacts Act Two for me, where it's like nothing gets to that level again. Like the Miller son is super close, but it's like, boy, like you really gave your all to this song. It's delightfully snappy. The syncopation is on point. The rhymes are beautiful. Like everything about this, I love. I can listen to it just over and over and over again. So that's my number one, A Weekend in the Country. And I will say, Weekend in the Country is probably what Twitter gave as number one. It was not an official poll. I was getting a lot of comments and retweets and stuff like that. So I would say that Weekend in the Country is number one on Twitter. Losing My Mind was the one that won over on Patreon. And like I said, Liaisons was the one that won over on Instagram. So those are kind of the three that are vying here a little bit, I would say, as far as what the audience thinks is the number one song. But that's where I would love you to tell me what I got wrong, which is probably, in most people's eyes, everything. What I do find really interesting here too is that it breaks down really nicely. And again, I did not do this on purpose. I was like, I was reordering things. I had a list and then remade it again. And then like looked at it a couple days later and was like, no, I think these songs have to go here. So I had to like reshuffle these a few times, but it breaks down to being three songs from Company, three songs from Follies, and then four songs from A Little Night Music. This is where I kind of come down to. I know that A Little Night Music is beloved in so many areas, but it's still a little bit slept on. I think that people just think of it as like the Send in the Clowns musical, when there's all these other songs that are so great and so well thought out within that show too. I'm looking forward to do this again when we go from like 1976 to 1980. And then we'll see where my opinions lie there. But that is going to do it for me here this week. Thank you so much for listening. Like I said near the beginning, you can send emails to puttingittogetherpodcast@gmail.com. You can also follow Sondheim Podcast on Twitter and Instagram. And you can support the show on Patreon by going to patreon.com/puttingittogetherpodcast. Thank you to the Alberta Podcast Network this week, to the Pod Power, and to Rumi. Putting It Together is available on Apple Podcasts, Google Podcasts, Spotify, and pretty much anywhere you can get podcasts from. Consider subscribing so that you never miss an episode. Next week, we're going to be talking about Act One of The Frogs. Just don't lick them. As always, a big thanks to the great Chris Taniguchi, who designed the podcast artwork, and Nick Driscoll for composing our theme music. Well, we've reached the end of our episode. Yes, I know. Goodbye for now.
twice as attention, 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 twice as attention,